This is the Benefits Buzz Podcast, your weekly pulse on what's happening in the world of employee benefits, brought to you by your friends at WEX, who believe in simplifying benefits for everyone. Now listen up and let's get buzzed. All right, welcome to another episode of the Biggity Benefits Buzz. My name is Eric Peel, I'm your host, and I'm joined as always by my co-host, Kelsey Burgad. Kelsey, did you like my, I listened to a lot of Crisscross when I was a kid, and so I was kind of doing the Miggity Mac Daddy, but I did Biggity Benefits Buzz. I thought it was pretty cool. What do you think?
I mean, it was really good. I'm too young for Crisscross, so I don't know.
Oh, shots fired. That's okay.
But I loved it. I thought it was great.
Well, thank you. Thank you so much. And my experiment to find the perfect opening for our podcast, I'm not sure if that one makes the cut, but...
The quest continues.
Well, hey, I am, every one of these episodes, we love in a unique way. And this is a really cool one that I've been looking forward to discussing because it talks about team performance. And I think as HR professionals, you know, part of our job, a lot of the things that, you know, kind of fall underneath the compass of what we need to do is, you know, think about how we make our organization better. That means how to make our teams perform better, how to make individuals perform better, in addition to all the other lovely things that HR pros have to do. But this is one of those things that I think we can all relate to. Like when I heard team performance, I'm like, yeah, I know exactly what we're talking about, right?
I love it. Yeah. I mean, it's one of those things that it's kind of the elephant in the room. And it's something that I think you have to work at to resolve. So I'm excited to have Jess Omley with us here today. She is the VP of Learning Experience at WEX, and she's going to talk to us about performance issues on a team.
Yeah, Jess, welcome to the show.
Hey, thanks so much. I am delighted to be here and excited to talk about this because this is one of the things that gets me really fired up.
I love it.
Well,
if you're fired up, we're going to be fired up. Jess, I have to ask you, did you get the Crisscross reference? Did you listen to Crisscross when you were growing
up? I totally got the Crisscross reference, Eric.
Thank you.
Eric, I got it too. I just like to give you a little bit of fun. I see how it is.
Well, thanks, Jess, for not giving me crap and getting the reference. Well, you know what? This is fun. I can't wait to have you dive into this. And I love that you're passionate about it because I'm passionate about it too. And I think what I love about this episode is we kind of talked about this before we got on the show is it's so easy to want to think about when we think about performance, it's so easy to think of that one person, right, that you can't stand working with, that, oh, they're never carrying their weight. They're not doing anything wrong. You know, they're doing everything wrong, blah, 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 right? But I think when we talked about it, sometimes the reality is that seems like the easy and most identifiable. But maybe what could be at play is there's a larger team dynamic that could be the issue as opposed to just one individual contributor. And I think that's something that through this discussion, there's gonna be a lot of light bulbs that go off, I think, for our listeners as we start to kind of uncover and make the difference between is it an individual issue or is it a larger issue that needs to be addressed team-wide? So anyway, I wanted to tease some of the stuff that we're going to be talking about, but let's talk about your passion for this, Jess. You talked about, why do you have that passion? Where did this spark and this interest for this particular topic come from?
Yeah, I think I can answer that in two ways. One is the really nerdy geek out way. And then the other is the really practical way. I mean, I don't know why some of us go down roads where we get passionate about one particular topic as to another, but in college, my major that I found when I was there, I didn't even know it was a thing before going to college, was organizational communication. And I just thought it was fascinating. It tapped into this curiosity that I had about how do organizations, which are essentially groups of people, how do they work together to achieve some common outcome and be successful? How does that happen and what makes it effective? So having that curiosity and asking those questions in college was one thing. And then over the years in my profession, which I'll just call learning and development for those of out here, because I think that's probably the most commonly used term amongst and across all industries. As I've been in learning and development, one of the things that happens is folks, managers, teams come to learning and development and they say, hey, we've got a performance issue on our team. Can you create some training to help us? And you know what? We love that. I mean, we love, it's great. We as learning and development professionals love nothing more than to create awesome training that will help out teams and help them to be more successful. But we also, like everyone else in the organization, have a responsibility to be effective and efficient and use our resources widely, or use wisely, I should say, using those resources in a wise way. And so training in reality takes a lot of time to create and conduct if you're going to do it well. It's time, it's resources, and we know that that means money in organization. So essentially, we're using a lot of dollars to create, facilitate, and then pull people out of production to go to training. And then we're spending time, money, and resources there. So with all of that at stake, I think I have a responsibility as a learning and development professional to ensure that we're helping whatever manager comes and says, hey, I need help, to reach their end goal. And oftentimes I've found that folks will come and say, hey, I need training to solve an issue, but that isn't really going to solve the problem. It's only part of the solution. Like, training might help with one thing, but it won't help with everything. So for example, and I think I shared this real briefly as we were chatting beforehand, if the technology isn't working, we can't out-train that. If there's a process on the team that's just really wonky and clunky and frustrating to everyone, training on better time management won't help a process that isn't working. So that kind of thing, I want to make sure, and our listeners, if they're listening, our HR professionals, if they have good learning and development departments, those learning and development departments won't just automatically say yes to every request. In fact, they'll come back with a series of questions to determine whether or not training is going to really solve the problem, so that when we put our time and effort and resources and money into creating a training, we know we've hit the mark.
So that's really where
it came from.
I love that, because, you know, I think I'm trying to align it to my own role. And I think it's very similar to marketing, where somebody comes to you and says, hey, here's XYZ problem. We need you to help marketing. Can you do XYZ? And the first thing that a good marketer is going to do is ask 300 questions. Mm-hmm. And I think sometimes people are like, well, wait a minute, I just need you to do X. Why are you asking me all these questions? And when I hear you talk, it sounds like it's very similar. So what would you say is the best way to get down to the root cause? I mean, maybe you might determine that training isn't actually going to be effective. How do you approach finding what the root cause is?
Well, I think it depends on the couple things. Number one, the relationship that you have with the person who's asking. So I'm a big fan of, how can we build relational capital all across the organization so that the first time you and I have a conversation, it is not a crucial conversation. It is not a moment where we have to go toe to toe. We already have some established trust between the two of us. And then I'm going to ask questions in such a way that is, hey, really lays out that we are trying to get to the same goal. You know, what you want your team to be successful. I want your team to be successful. Let me ask a few more questions to understand what that looks like. So what does team success look like for you? Where are you trying to get to at the end of the day? I start with that. Oftentimes, if it's a training request, I'm looking for, well, what does good look like? So a very common one is, hey, can you come do some communication training for our team? Okay, well, what does good communication look like? Well, it looks like they're communicating well. Well, what does that mean? Because we can't just train on a generic communication and assume that it's going to hit the mark. And oftentimes what will happen is then we'll get to this point after asking several questions where the stakeholder that's come to us is kind of gets at a loss. And they say, I guess I don't really know. And then I say, well, I can help you with that, which is, I know, part of what we're going to talk about today. I can help you with that if you give me a little bit of access to some of the people on your team and some of the work that you're doing, and we can have a little more in-depth conversation. Are you open to that? And then at that point, usually folks say, yeah, I am. What can you find out? How much time is it going to take you? Those kind of things. And then we go from there. So that's where I start. But I'll tell you why I think that folks come for training in the first place, which is, I think, gets us to the same point. And I can do that in a fun way. I'll give you kind of a fun story. So let me ask you both, Eric and Kelsey, have you ever had in your lives a time when your car didn't start?
Yes.
Okay. So if you would humor me, do you remember the make and model of the car just for fun? This part's just fun. Okay. What is it? What was it, guys?
Mine was a Ford Edge.
Ooh, fancy. Mine was a Pontiac Fiero.
Oh, wow.
What's that?
it was like my car in high school. If you look it up, it's like this two-seater sports car. It's a two-seater sports car, but it's like the poor person sports car. It's like the cheap, like $6,000.
With Chris Cross banging out the window.
Oh, you just encapsulated my high school. Thank you.
Now we have the full picture.
Yeah,
okay, so I also had a car like that. It was my college vehicle. It was a 1989 gold Honda Civic, four-door automatic transmission, and it was a bit of a stickler. So it very frequently did not start. My sister calls it the lemon car, but it was gold, not lemon. But anyway, it frequently didn't start, and there was a trick to it. The trick was all you had to do was open the gas cap. And then it would start. Now, this was not to put gas in because that would be way too easy. Some mechanic had taken pity on a poor college student knowing that I could not afford an expensive repair and said, hey, there's this problem with the pressure in your fuel line. If you open the gas cap when it doesn't start, it'll release the pressure and then your car will start. I'm sure there's a much more scientific explanation than that, but it worked for me every time. So I didn't need to know all the science. I just needed to know that it worked and it would get me where I needed to go. And it worked almost every time until one day. And that one day happened to be a February morning in Minnesota, below zero, freezing. And I came out of my little college apartment to my gold Honda Civic, and I'm going to my job at McDonald's. And I get in and I start to turn the key and nothing happens. No problem. I get out, I open the gas cap. Exactly. Get back in, turn the key, nothing. Now, it normally didn't take more than one time, but I thought maybe this time it would. So I got out, opened the gas cap. So I did this a few more times and nothing happened. I didn't know what to do. Something was obviously wrong. Ended up calling my then college boyfriend who came over. We were fiddling with it. We ended up then calling his farmer father, who has significantly more knowledge of mechanics than we do. And he's fiddling with it. And several hours later, and it was freezing outside, several hours later, Farmer Father notices one very important detail. The car was not in park.
Oh, Jess.
I was going to say, were you out of gas? I mean.
No, but seriously, I'm still embarrassed about that story. And it is decades later. But how this relates to our organizations and team issues is oftentimes we are so used to solving problems, and likely our HR professionals, if they're at any point in their career, and our managers and our stakeholders, they're great at solving problems. They solve a move on, that we don't look beyond the surface and the symptom. We solve, we move on, and we miss seemingly important details.
I love this because Hayden, our producer of the show, actually recommended a book to me by Adam Grant called Think Again.
Yes,
and that's what he talks about in the book is your brain is so focused on what you think you know that oftentimes you're just like you're driving towards A when you should really be going to like C.
Mm-hmm. So we get blinded. And if it hasn't happened already, what we assume we know actually creates a blind spot to what's actually happening. And if we don't see what's actually happening, we waste resources. In my instance with the car example, it was time. It was money because I didn't get to work that day. It was warmth. And it could have gone further because what if I would have had to have that car towed and taken to a mechanic, and now I've paid a mechanic to all find out that this one silly little detail was all it would have taken to fix it.
What a great story. And thank you for sharing your embarrassment and for helping others. So there's a couple
that
of things.
That is why.
Right. It's all for learning. And I love that. So one, couple of things. First thing first, we are both org comm nerds. So I went to graduate school in org comm. So you're living the life I thought I was going to live, Jess. And then I fell in love with marketing and everything else, but I would love to offline and talk more about all that fun stuff, which is why I get so passionate about this. I'm realizing now. And two, I love your story because that's the hardest thing, right? So you talked about, I think there's going to be a variety of HR professionals who are listening to this right now. There are some that, guess what? They have to wear a gazillion hats, and part of their job not only is to also do training and to try and lead, right? May not be fortunate to have a learning and development team on staff. And some do, right? And I think to your point is, if they usually like a manager's coming to someone saying, hey, I've got an employee that's just not, we need to work with them. What can we do? Right. And the point is with your story is you have to figure out what is the actual issue and what are the symptoms, identifying the symptoms, but then really find out what is, you know, what is the real reason that they're, that the team or this individual experiencing problems. So what I want from you, Jess, if you can help our listeners understand, is how do we figure out what that real issue is? How do you go beyond the symptom and figure out it's not the gas cap? I didn't have it in park. And that I think, you know, because that's going to be the reality, is that the manager's going to want an easy fix. Go help, Joe Blow over here. He's got an issue. Where do you figure out, and where can an HR professional figure out and say, okay, I definitely hear, I want to learn more. What are those 300 questions that Kelsey talked about she wants to ask? And how do you pinpoint what that real reason is? What's that process that they can learn? Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So I can go through 5 different steps that I follow when I'm working with different teams. And I can give you a few examples along the way if you're interested of what we've learned along the way. But before I even get into those 5 examples, they have to be guided by one assumption. So you have to start with this key assumption or the model doesn't work. And the assumption is this: if you really want to solve a team or an organizational performance issue, you have to start by assuming you don't know the cause or the solution yet. Mm. You'll get there. But what happens when we start by assuming we don't know is it automatically shifts our brain into curiosity mode. And so instead of going to problem solving mode, we start with curiosity and we move from problem solver to detective. And we see the symptom as only a clue that something else is going on. So the symptom of my car not starting was just a clue that something was going on. So at that point, I need to gather the clues and figure it out, and you become open to possibility. So that's the first assumption. That's where we start, is with that assumption. Then I've got 5 different steps, and it'll take us just a bit of time to go through each, so I can give a little bit of an explanation on each. So the first one, so we'll pause. If you have questions, gosh, you guys, just interrupt me, because I can get really excited about this. And then I just keep going. And then pretty soon you say, yep, Jess, you've been talking a long time. So give me pauses when I can.
Yeah, no, I love it. And we'll hit those. Let's hit those 5 steps, Jess. And then if there's one that gets Kelsey and I particularly excited, we'll dive into one of those, maybe, if that works for you.
Fantastic. We'll do. All right. So the first step is to define your measurable performance outcome. So this is basically what should be happening. So you need to define what should be happening on the team. And it may be that it's likely that it's not happening. But there's something very specific about this that you've got to keep in mind. You're looking for results that the team should be achieving. You are not looking at how they should achieve them. And it's very important to make that distinction, because the how is oftentimes just a personal preference. And that is sometimes where we get in trouble. So now step one was defining what should be happening. Step two is to determine what is happening. Where are your gaps? And the best way to do this, the best way to do this is to really look back at your people. And I say to look at a couple different groups, your key performers and your standard performers and their managers. So key performers are the people on the team who just seem to knock it out of the park no matter what. And when I say this, I'm talking about key performers as people who are achieving the results. Not necessarily just the people that everyone likes, because you don't have to like someone for them to be good at the results. They're getting the numbers. If you run those numbers from those measurable performance outcomes, somehow there's some people that just seem to be killing it. Standard performers are the people who are on the average spectrum. I mean, they're doing what they need to do. They're getting the work done. They're just not high achievers in terms of getting the results done. And when you look at most teams, they'll shake out in somewhat of a bell curve. On the low end, you've got a few folks who are low performers. On the other high end, you've got your key performers. And then in the middle, you've got kind of most of the team. That's where they sit, which is just generally how things fall out. what you want to do is take, what do the key performers do that makes them different and sets them apart? What have they figured out that the standard performers haven't quite figured out yet? Because think if you could take everybody who's in that average part of the bell curve and just shift them up a little bit to do all do work the way the key performers do. You would shift the whole performance of your team. Usually key performers have figured out a way to do things that's a little bit different. They've skipped steps. They're more efficient for some reason. They've thrown out the processes and made their own. They have some resources that they created themselves that they utilize frequently, that kind of thing.
Yeah, absolutely. I think these are all great things to think about. And I think, right, like, again, the default is to take the easy way out, talk to the individual, try and fix one individual, potentially performance issue, when again, in order to do the best job at discovering what needs to be shifted and altered and changed, is to take that kind of objective step back, look at what needs to be accomplished and how is it being accomplished, right? Who's performing well, who's not performing well, to figure out where are their efficiencies, because that can be kind of your gauge. That totally makes sense. I love this, and I love the path that we're going down. I want to make sure we're also conscious of time, Jess. If we look at steps 3 through 5, once we have those things kind of, I think, prepared in our back pocket, how do we kind of move to the part where we look at sort of analyzing, and then how do we get to the part where we start to kind of say, okay, here's some of the feedback that I can provide, and how do HR professionals do that, right?
Yep. So that is steps 3 through 5. Oh, and honestly,
sweet.
I know, you're so good. You don't even know it. It's that org comm in you. No, steps 1 and 2 honestly take the longest, because that's the part that most of us skip. We want to skip right to the solution. So when we get to step 3, now is when we take all the data that we just collected about what should be happening and what is happening, and we're looking for trends. We're looking for trends of what everyone's doing and they're doing well, and then where those gaps are. So what is it that people are doing differently, key performers versus standard performers? Where are the gaps? So as we look at those, that's when we start to identify where we can apply solutions. So step 3 is matching the gaps to the cause. So essentially you're doing the analysis and figuring out where are those gaps happening and what's the cause. It could be things like structure, process, could be resources, could be not having access to the information they need, could be not having the knowledge or skills they need, could be rewards or motives on the team. Are we rewarding the right things to promote the work we need to get done? Could be personal capacity or capability. Maybe we don't even have the right hiring profile. We're not hiring for the right skills. So those are all things we might find as potential causes. Then we take and apply the best solutions depending on where we found the cause. And the way I like to think about solutions is with looking at two things, difficulty and impact. So how difficult is it going to be to implement this kind of solution, and what's the impact? We aim to start with things that are low difficulty, high impact. So if it's something, if it's just, let's say it's a work, let's say it's a workflow issue or a process issue, and all we need to do is make a few tweaks to the process. We found that our key performers do that just a little bit differently, and that makes them more efficient. Mm-hmm. That's low difficulty, high impact. Now, if we have something like, let's say we find out that we need to make some changes to our technology, and that's going to involve some development or something like that, that's going to take a little longer. It's going to take making a business case, creating some buy-in, all of that. So then we make a plan to do that over time. It's high difficulty, high impact. So then we make a plan for that. And then step 5 is just to go right back to the beginning, measure our effectiveness. Did we move the needle on our measurable performance outcomes? Are we now better at the results than we were before as a result of what we did? So that's how we get there.
It's a very scientific approach. It almost feels like I'm back in, I don't know what grade I learned, you know, like hypothesis. Do you know what I'm talking about? Am I losing you guys?
Oh, no.
But it seems like it's that approach, because then you're going back to the beginning and you're checking, your hypothesis, which I know you weren't really supposed to hypothesize. So maybe I'll just scratch my analogy.
Well, and I mean, a hypothesis is kind of a guess, but in this instance, we're talking about results and they're measurable. So we're checking to see if the solution we applied worked.
Yeah.
So yeah, in some ways it is.
Yeah, and what's good, I think of a Brian McKnight song, Back at One, which is another classic.
Oh, yes.
I know, right? Start from the beginning. I can't get music out of my head.
I think we had that one at our wedding.
Yeah, see? And all the classic jams. You know what? It's so funny that you totally called me on it too when you were going through your five-step process, is that I initially wanted to be like, Yeah. Observe. But what is the action, right? And I think that's, you know, I am guilty of probably everyone who just want to go and fix, right?
As an introvert, I want to fix.
And so I love that you laid out all five. And even though I wanted to get to the action, it's really, really important we look at those first two steps. So I don't want to discredit them. I think it's just sort of me realizing human nature is we immediately want to go and fix something, but we have to make sure and go through each process to really understand what we're looking to measure and accomplish and how it's being done right now. So thanks for humoring me there.
I probably should have warned you at the beginning, because when I have talked with groups before, I've said, we're going to spend most of our time on 1 through 3, because that's where most people skip. They want to go right to 4, which is the solutioning.
Instant gratification.
If we don't do 1 through 3, we haven't done ourselves any favor. We've probably wasted time, money, warmth, whatever the thing is that's at stake at that point.
So now I'm curious, you know, we started with the ask of the manager or the leader of that team where we need training to fix X. How often after you go through this process, have you found that it was really a training need versus something else?
Very rarely is it really a training need. I think, you know, we definitely need training when we have new employees because they don't know anything. But training can really only solve for helping you improve knowledge and skills. And that's the one part, that's the one thing that training can solve for. If it's anything other than that, we aren't really very effective in training in solving a workflow or a process issue. We can't solve if your people are being incentivized to do certain things on it on the team and that's why they're not getting other tasks done, that training isn't going to help that. So I think I did read a stat at one point in some of the research that I've done that training will solve the issue about 10 to 15% of the time. Now, I'm not trying to work myself out of a job per se.
Hey, you know, but 10, 50% of the time, I'm the person.
Right, exactly. And there's different.
That was kind of where my guess was, though, you know, like a lower number, because I think people like to blame training sometimes for these problems. But that was that was where my guess was.
Yeah. And again, I think there's a time and a place for training, or sometimes training is a part of the solution, but it's not sufficient to solve the entire problem.
Yeah, they're absolutely right. It's totally going to be a combined effort with a variety of things. And training is probably one of those components. Well, Jess, thank you so much. I think we're going to for sure outline those five steps in our notes of the podcast, so that when you're listening, if you weren't taking meticulous notes, you can look back at our podcast notes or even our blog that we do on each of our episodes to check that out. Maybe to wrap, if there's kind of one piece of advice for our listeners out there who might be, you know, interested in rethinking how they address these issues, you know, or something that you've kind of picked up along the way, Jess, what would it be, right? Kind of that one last nugget of knowledge to take from the show.
If I had to pick anything, I would go back to that assumption that we started with, which is when you're feeling like we got to move, we got to get to the solution, that should be your clue to say, nope, sit on your hands, bite your tongue, and remain curious. So assume when you see a problem that you don't actually know what the cause is yet. So if you start there, you'll engage your curiosity and you'll begin to ask questions in a different way. That'll trigger the whole rest of the process.
That's awesome. And I was happy to be an example of what not to do.
I almost said to you, do you feel my eyes on you right now, Eric?
It's so good. That's how we learn though, right? And I was happy to be that example because it is human nature to do that. You're very welcome. Happy to be the person who messed things up every time. Well, Jess, thank you so much. I truly appreciate your expertise. I know there's a lot of HR pros who are going to probably are dealing with an existing performance issue right now. And it's good for them to sit back, remain curious, and do those five steps that you talked about to alleviate some of that team performance. Mm-hmm. So thanks you so much for sharing with that. I have to say before we wrap, you know, Kelsey made a comment about Adam Grant, who we're all kind of fans of. We actually have a huge event coming up called Spark that WEX is putting on. It's and Adam Grant actually is a keynote talking about the whole concept of runway thinking. So it's a great kind of transition with this or dovetail with this podcast episode. And if you want it, it's a free event that WEX is doing. So HR pros, if you're interested in learning from Adam Grant and these other keynote speakers we have, is fantastic. You can go to wexspark.com, register. It's a free event. Do that. I have to put a shameless plug in there because that's how we do. But with that said, thank you so much, Jess. I appreciate everything you've done. And thanks for coming to the show again. We appreciate it.
Absolutely. My pleasure.
WEX is in the business of simplifying benefits for everyone. Now, although we certainly hope our podcast sparks some aha moments, like that was pretty cool, but of course we cannot provide legal, investment, or financial advice. And, well, therefore, nothing shared in this podcast should be interpreted as such. We encourage you to seek out appropriate professional advice regarding your plans. Hey, congratulations! You made it through our disclaimer. Thanks for listening.